baseball.
I'm talking about like, I'm talking about high school baseball where like, it like,
That's hard.
He's played three games, and we have a game tomorrow morning, and I'm at Blair, and then he's just got, he heard he's one of the people getting called up to play with the varsity team on Monday, because like all these kids were for spring break, so they needed a few kids, and sometimes it gets to go up, so he's like, yeah.
Welcome to the George Washington University Museum and the Textile Museum. My name is Lori Karcher and I'm the Curator of Education here at this museum. And we're just so happy to welcome you into the exhibition space. This is a very special opportunity for us to be able to do programming right here in the galleries and also to partner with our friends at the Corcoran School of Music and also the UGW Creative Writing Program. You may have sort of had a chance to see what's going on behind me as we walked into the gallery. So I just wanted to mention a little bit about this work of art before we get started. So what you're looking at is an installation that's specific to this site. The artist Anna Lindberg has created this using colored yarns. So maybe when you walked in you weren't sure if you were looking at light or if you were looking at yarns, or yarns illuminated by light. But they are in fact made out of six different colors of yarn, but intended to create this illusion of light. And the artist was invited to create this installation here in our museum alongside the exhibition on level two, which features prayer carpets from various traditions around the Muslim world. And one theme down on the lower level is the concept of divine light, as depicted by a lantern or a lamp hanging in the archway. And knowing this, and knowing her own artistic practice, Anna Lindberg decided to focus on the concept of light in this installation, calling it here instead of a specific religious tradition being referred to, posing it as a question. What color is divine light? And through her piece is illuminating our space with this, to me, it looks like a ray of light. And she often works with colors that have a relationship to each other, or the concept of colors that maybe go together or don't go together, and how optics is part of how you might experience color or experience light as a person. So, has anyone ever heard of impossible colors before? One nod, a few no's. Impossible colors are those that maybe are opposing each other. Red and green, blue and yellow. That when they kind of come close to one another, they don't, your eye actually cannot make them blend. And so it kind of has this vibration effect, but your eyes have to sort of actually interpret these colors. And light is also what allows you to see colors. And so I really love this piece as a sort of a question about light, a question about color, but also a question about divinity. Because all of these things, at least according to this artist, maybe is interpreted through how it's filtered through you, through your eyes, through your experience as a person. So it's a really special piece for us to have a contemporary contemporary installation, but also it's very, very special for us to have an exhibition with a big open floor plan, where there's actually a lot of space for us to gather, just like we're doing this evening, and activate the installation through programming. So we've had other types of things in here, like meditation. We had poetry reading with creative writing about a month ago, music performances, and tours and conversations in this space to really activate the question, what color is divine light, together as a community. So thank you for being here. We're very excited to do this again with Ars Poetica. So with that introduction, I'll introduce Douglas Boyce, who will introduce Ars Poetica and the program for this evening.
Thank you very much, Lori. This is a compositional project and a performance that the idea and the work on it began just a bit before COVID. And so to, in some ways, finally have all of these connections becoming active, becoming alive. It's really wonderful. And through perhaps some happy accidents, I think, connects to the installed piece really quite wonderfully. So you'll find in, if you go online with the program, there's a bunch of information and who is who, but I think most importantly, the text of the poems are there. This is a piece that's a sort of joint creative project with poet Marlanda Dekine, who we'll see in just a moment. She's one there in the excellent spectacles, in fact. And Marlanda and I met perfectly by chance at a retreat center in the hills of North Carolina, where my then four-year-old boy decided that we should have lunch with this person who was there. And we sort of marched over and just sort of sat down next and ate some lentils and had sort of lovely conversations about things. And so for me, there's always something wonderful in the way artists come together. And at the same time, that coming together is rarely predictable. It's rarely hard. It's rare that you're able to sort of guess where it's going to lead you. And so we had conversations, we continued to chat and to talk on the phone and get a sense of what we're doing. We thought it might be fun to work on something together. And what we ended up settling on, as you will see in the poetry and as the name of the work, Ars Poetica, it is, hopefully, a piece about craft. It's a piece about the process of making something and how maybe that process of making is always collective. And it's always connected either to the past or to the people that you're working with or the composer and the poet or amongst the players. We'll see as the piece starts. The relationships between the people on the stage shift. Sometimes it is Marlanda that is primary. There are relatively long passages where Marlanda's silent, and there's this elaborate musical dialogue happening between them. And then Marlanda returns, and then sometimes one overwhelms the other. I'll be honest, that's kind of why I love music. I think that's what's sort of the most beautiful music. It's always happening. And yet here tonight, we also have this. Again, beautiful happenstance of this installation at this moment, where the colors and the layers and the strings are in this complex dialogue within themselves. While at the same time, we hear the people here from the Corcoran School of the Arts and Design and the textile music, we're also coming to understand what it is to be together and how to interact with one another. And so I've been very happy that this has all played out the way that it has, even though it did take a bit longer than our original plan was. So, thank you very much for joining us. I want to clarify a couple things about process, which is that there's going to be a piece, then Marlanda is going to be share some more poetry from her own book, and then we're going to have some readings from students from the creative writing program, and there'll be little waystones for you to understand where we are in the process. Thank you very much. Please enjoy, and please welcome Marlanda Dekine and counter.
I wobble down a cobble road. I left a bottle of brown rum at the crossroads. My limb is getting fuller by the moon. I wonder who plotted this path, this map. I make my life. I am swift as the spaceships behind my eyelids. Beauty finds me dappled in ecstasy. I found by the magnolia outside. Outer space views might blow all our minds. songs from deep within. Oh, cry and cry, ocean, sky, let down the rain. I will savor in the mess of mud, draw all my fears in.
Thank you.
around to be picked up. Words I choose. I give myself permission. I will not apologize for the blue. Butterfly dancing in my hydrangeas. Memories. There are many things seen. I dream space of no time, I before, of dark sounds beat, evil eye down my back. Here is happy as a crow perched upon my crown for lunch. At Winya Bay, I do not require you. And I love big is all that water. Big is all that water holding stories. I ripple out love. I breathe like the live oak. I stand rooted. I speak to you plain. There is much I have to say. I love myself now. I love myself. This here being, which means I can feel you. Telling you these are loops we are living in. There is no time. I'm hands up, don't you? I needed you to see me. I did not write anything I meant to say. What I mean to say is the writing is best when I don't know where I'm going. Where I'm going might be black as my granddaddy's face, topsoil beneath crimson clover. I was shiny and I was for sale. Now all I want is growing a garden lush inside of me. We all grow when one does. We all know suffering because we are alive. When I realized I was alive, decay and fear left my front porch. Hate blue began to speak alongside mugwort gone to seed. I listened to cinnamon sticks boiling on my stove. I put my head over steam of basil, said, hello being, we are alive, kiss the day. When I entered my third decade of bad lady, I was alone inside, remembering little me who loved stars, feared the night, counting evergreens as I passed by. I think about how much love it took to survive.
Thank you.
trying to get my lesson how Grandma said. By reading the poem that inspired Ars Poetica. It's by Henry Dumas. It's called Outer Space Blues. People, I heard the news the other day, like to scare me half to death. Yeah, things happen in this world like to scare me half to death. TV say a spaceship is coming here. If it do, won't be no people left. But I tell you folks, spaceship can't be so bad. Reckon I just fooled people. Spaceship can't be too bad. I've been on Earth all my life, and all my life I've been mad. So when the spaceship land, I ain't running too fast. I say, I reckon I might not run too fast. I might run over into Mississippi, and you know I can't pass. Hold it, people. I see a flying saucer coming. Guess I wait and see. Yeah, a spaceship coming. Guess I wait and see. All I know, they might look just like me.
Ah, the snaps. The snaps, yes. It's not poetry reading until the snaps.
I'm going to be reading a few poems from my debut collection, Thresh and Hold, published by Hub City Press. I'll tell you a little bit more about the book after I've read the poems. I am bound for the kingdom after Florence Price and Marian Anderson. My granddaddy Silas was born on the Nightingale Plantation in Plantersville, South Carolina, on riverbanks that love. Three generations of my kin captured in a green-tinted photograph hanging in my daddy's den. Tonight, my eyes will take each old world bird from the crop space, send them home with their songs and favorite foods. Look out for me, I'm a-coming too. With rice, okra, hard-boiled eggs, and Lord Calvert. My daddy says if I get out of my car on Nightingale Land, the folks who own it might shoot. My daddy says, never leave the driveway. Glory into my soul. I watch all of my ascendants, their faces reflecting me in that photograph. Their eyes are dead, black-eyed Susans. Hurricane family. When hurricanes come, my daddy prepares by rooting souls into the floors of our house, rooted into the wetland his daddy poured Lord Calvert into. No longer a buckler, sharecropper, Grandma Lizzie and Granddaddy Silas rooted a bottle tree of 12 inconceivable indigo children. My daddy repeats to my mom, we'll be fine, and I believe. When the hurricanes come, it moves me more than I want. I hook my innocence inside. Wild water becomes swords. My sisters and I played in swooning pine. Dark, slick, splash, and I was terrified. My thoughts of trees falling on top of mobile homes. People waking with blue earth inside their rooms. Worlds swept up for miles off. Worlds swept up for miles out all around. And in our front yard, I was afraid. While we ran, we danced, and we leaped. Collecting myself, I opened the door and all the girls were gone. No one was peeking into my bathroom stall anymore. No one asked me if I am a boy today. It was just me, sitting on a cold floor, waiting to open my eyes. I imagined their spit was river water shined by moon. I could drink from it. Their laughter bloomed into my bloody noses. I loved all the girls. The closest I got to one of them was in fourth grade PE when India aimed the baseball and caught me hard in my eye. She ran over before the teacher could see, and she searched my face for blood. I waited for her to pick me up like I belonged to her. This is the titular piece, the title poem. Thresh and Hold. Flooding in now, I rest, so I can harvest new worlds already met so still. Without rest, I cannot hear my grandma Lizzie and my grandma Thelma. Without rest, I cannot hear my Aunt Carolyn composing for her Lord. I cannot hear my Aunt Angie cussing angels while guiding me across memory waters. I am learning what real power is. A year ago, I wouldn't have felt our bright red, black, green cords of spirit calling. Women in my family have dropped dead one day, and the family kept right on working. I rest like I have tomorrows, growing on a vine outside. I rest like a horned owl. My ancestors turned into machines by rice is booming in Georgetown, sale extravaganza. I rest beneath my grandma Lizzie's oil-dressed magnolia, painted white and green at the trunk. I risk surrender to her dark sachet. West Africa caught my granddaddy Silas by the brain. Here's a cosmos I picked from his field of grasses. Women in my family have dropped dead one day, purple gown and waiting for us in the next. Y'all all right? All right. In this next poem, one note, the pronouns that I use are E and M. In Gullah Geechee language, I'm a descendant of Gullah Geechee people, and in Gullah Geechee language, the gender-neutral pronoun is E, M. I can't say that Gullah Geechee people are gender-inclusive, but what I will say on this day of trans visibility is that I had fun as a poet playing with these pronouns and making them a part of the work. From this point in the book, the rest of the pronouns continue to be E, M. Grain memory. A wishbone branch falls from my grandma Thelma's oak for me. What do you know about magic? He asks. He bends the old body down, turns the wishbone branch into a cross, places it around my neck. I am strapped at the Black River's right shoulder, remembering my grandpa Mose never wore anything but church. My purple head begins to feel cold as clergy, parched. I ask for water. He gives me water and rice, says to repeat after him. I am fly from nature, nature fly. 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 Ah, I get it. It's an affirmation, I say. And he laughs in wind ocean songs. He whispers, do not be trapped by language. A voice begins to beat my chest, cavity and rhythm, chaff threshed from grain, separating me from need. I thought I'd snap that wishbone branch myself. No, I am fly from nature, nature fly. At dusk, gleaming marigolds gathered beneath my feet singing, we were stolen, shipped across the Atlantic. Invasive is a word I heard. Stolen. Thrash, thrash, thrash. And we speak in blue. This is the last poem I'll read, and then I'll talk a little bit about Ars Poetica. Home body. My bones are not just my own. I feed them honey, oranges, copper, and crystals. I clear my soul. My skeletal holds a mouthful of mundane magic. I come from everywhere. My words go everywhere. The wind always brings me back my first face. A red serpent circles my feet, forming itself into infinity. There, another bloody October moon. I am watching. Pine trees pick up their roots and walk. Thank you. So, an Ars Poetica is a meditation on the art of poetry. And for me, that makes it also a meditation on the meaning of life while living through precarious times. Henry Dumas was a poet, teacher, a civil rights activist, and so much more. And he was shot by police in a case of mistaken identity during the late 1960s. When I first read his poem, Outer Space Blues, the poem that inspired Ars Poetica, I knew I had read a blues poem by a poet who was from the South, Arkansas. I didn't know any other aspect of his life, including how he died. My poem, Ars Poetica, has a few lines in it that go, I'm 16 years old, hands up, don't shoot, and the cop has a finger on the trigger, and anywhere is everywhere. Took 20 years for that fear to leave my wonderful body. I think this autobiographical moment in my poem has a felt connection to Dumas without my intention to make it so. So I want to share a little bit about how Ars Poetica was written. I use a process called automatic writing. Some people call it free writing or even spirit writing. Two other poets I know of that use this process were Lucille Clifton and William Butler Yeats. The way it works for me is I would take my dog out for long walks, very long walks. He passed in November, but we would go on long walks together. And then I'd come home, set a timer for about 10 minutes, and during those 10 minutes, I'd write anything down without stopping. And as best as I could, I tried to write without thinking about what I was writing. I was free writing, or channeling, or spirit writing, or reaching for my stream of consciousness. I don't really know. I don't know. From this process, though, over time, lots of time that Douglas gave me, came the stanzas for Ars Poetica. I believe the text for this work is largely connected to my existence as a gender non-conforming black person in the world, as well as being a descendant of trafficked West and Central Africans who made a home in Plantersville, South Carolina. But again, I don't know. My poetry collection, Thresh and Hold, travels these same roads. A few of the poems you heard were written in this automatic writing process. However, there's much craft involved after that process. It's filled with familial connections and a reclamation of place and going beyond gender, and that's what this collection is about. I appreciate you all for listening to Ars Poetica, for listening to Thresh and Hold, and I hope you enjoy the student poets that will be coming to join you. Thank you.
Like their poems, which which investigates sound both linguistically and acoustically. We'll hear first from Wella, then Abby, then Anhel, but I'll read their bios for you first. Wella Lobaton is a first-year graduate student in the Women's Gender and Sexuality Studies program at the George Washington University with a concentration in postcolonial studies. Her work appears or is forthcoming from Women in and Beyond the Global, Rhino, AAWW's The Margins, Poet Lore, and Elsewhere, an impressive list of publications. They were born in Muscat, Oman, and now live in Northern Virginia with their family. Abby Chittenden is a senior undergraduate at the George Washington University studying international affairs and Spanish. Her poetry explores themes of queer identity and nostalgia, and her home state of Massachusetts often seeps into her work. On her playlists, you can find Maggie Rogers, Nancy Starr, and Lauryn Hill. Anhel Lagunas was born and raised in Houston, Texas, and is a junior currently studying creative writing at the George Washington University with a focus on poetry and creative nonfiction. They have been published in GW zines such as Capital Letters and Foggy Medium. Topics of interest that influence their work include music, immigration, and natural imagery. And now let's welcome our first reader, Wella Lobaton.
I'm a little too short for this. Hello, everyone. My name is Wella. Thank you, Professor Thea, for introducing me. When Professor Thea reached out a few weeks ago about me being part of this event, I wasn't sure which poems to read, but then I realized last spring, when I was in her advanced poetry writing class, she assigned us to write ekphrastic poems, and the first poem that I'll be reading was inspired by an exhibition here at the Textile Museum from last spring. It was an exhibit on South Asian textiles and just like how much work and value women put into various types of textiles. The title of my first poem is Considerations on Textiles as Text. Considered undoing of a weft, bared out for viewership, framed by default, tread upon tread on display for looming decay. Consider the pattern that dances, two-dimensional in its interests, zigzagging in your face, an offhand manipulation for your eyes. Consider the women who cloak you. Her hands are small and crowned with calluses, a lifetime in running stitches across cotton, resisting. Consider the deep blue divide, cleaving the room open, wounded, draped in the shadows of another unwestern world. Consider the dedication to quilting. Inhale the coming together, patches upon patches, the speed of one stitch per second. Consider the act of unfraying. We love most when we mend loose ends and close up with tread, each needle point a promise of release. Consider our lineage in one spool of thread. As with every folk song, all things come to an end. I pray not for severance, only an occupied grace. Thank you. And my second poem is going to be a poem that I've always wanted to share, so thank you so much again for this opportunity, and thank you for listening to me. My second poem is entitled Inheritances. One of the first things I learned was that my maternal grandfather was a farmer, and that he suffered for every grain of rice I put into my grieving mouth. We count our blessings before we go to sleep to make sure that we're making ends meet. But don't count your chicks before the eggs have hatched. Hens can claw at your face just as ferociously as their husbands. It takes 20 years to know your parents, and only 20 months to betray them. How old do we have to be before we learn how to hallucinate? Tenderness is earned in this household. I learned how to pick up individual rice grains with the pads of my fingers. Waste not, want not. Every granular detail can be taken out of context and passed down through bird songs on Sunday mornings before church. Only our eyes can remain sunken in, like our feet resisting the pull of the paddies. What can we do but watch as another affectionately named typhoon blows away our crops like an eyelash off of a child's cheek? Thank you so much. Next door is going to be Abby.
Okay, so I would have loved to incorporate singing into this piece. However, I am not a singer. And sometimes when I sing, my sister likes to go, "Ooh, key change," when I didn't change keys. So I did not do that, and you're welcome for that. But I wanted to write a poem about the experience of live music and how that can kind of be a source of connection for people, especially queer people. So this is a poem called "Maggie Rogers Loves Me." Girls only want one thing, and it's each other. I have proof. I was there at the concert when horses started playing and the lights were too effervescent to make sense of, and 1,000 people had something in common. And I think I finally get it, why a musician might go to Harvard for divinity school and might come back wielding feral joy. I wanted this moment to be mine, wanted to do it myself and never tell anyone of the shattered glass it took to get there. It's easier, I mean, to not speak of these things, to let that look in her eye go unnamed, because I don't have a melody for that. But what a disservice it would be to you, to myself, to Maggie Rogers, if I didn't at least try to put it into words. How the light painted crosses on a crowd like religion or something, I don't know, I didn't go to divinity school. How the bass line called me brave, how I know the color of her eyes in darkness. I think the point is this. Her hand is on my back, a spot I can never reach. So I have the words, but Maggie's got the meaning. I could break a glass just to watch it shatter, and I think that's something like a song.
Second, but my first poem is called Oldies, and I really like Mexican oldies. They're called bolero music, and yeah, just for a little bit of context, I just wanted to say, actually, it doesn't need full context. Okay, it's called Oldies. Spotify blend gives me an estimate of how close our taste in love or despair is. When it says 95%, I know our relationship should last us at least until the end of summer. When the sun hits the horizon and our shoulders are mountains convergent, I think that the blending of our lips could mean the constellations' alignments have meant the planets' rotations. Finally, Spotify rap tells me I've been exploring the taste of newness, such as the swift movement of hips, unpredictable feet, curling of wrists. There are a couple songs, though, I keep coming back to. It's that 5% I keep holding on to. This is the necrastic poem that I'm speaking of. The silence penetrates my heart. Rest. Then the chords strike like the cuts of a thin string, sudden and sharp and gentle, like the water after a flood. Those that tell the weather speak about 100-year floods. But what about the weekly puddles that deprive of sunshine, but clarify that we can't predict the forecast perfectly? Okay. For my last piece, I wrote this a couple days ago. I wrote it after I found out about 39 people that died in Juarez after setting fire to their beds when they found out they were being deported. And so for this, I ask that you close your eyes when I read this. Title is, Why is Today a Normal Day? For those of us that keep on losing. There's not really a song that quite captures the uneasiness that makes my hand quiver as I write this. Like when I'm home, sleeping, with a pocket knife under my flat pillow, dreaming of raids inside my room, always rising before I know if we win the bullet battle. I am dehydrated from all the rivers I've cried, from all the rivers we've almost drowned in, meaning different things to my parents than it does to me. They've crossed borders with brassy voices behind them, calloused by the steps in the sun of the Sonoran, pruny fingers from the Grande, and I used to carry all my burdens on rest notes. Slaves used to sing to cope with their captivity, wading in the water, were different shades with a similar somber. In the back of house, the dishwasher plays, Otis Redding sitting on the dock of the bay, washing the half-eaten plates to ease the agony of wanting to leave our current cages. 39 people died today, making their beds represent the rigel that exists within their ribcage, attempting to escape the return to their own bullet battles. We must turn their ashes into phoenixes, because if we forget to carry our beloved like the melodies in the back of our minds, who will remember the way those songs made us feel? Thank you. Vigil on Saturday at Lafayette Square, that's in the White House, at 7:20. So Saturday, April 8th, Lafayette Square. Be there, be square.
Thank you all for coming. I was supposed to do the pre-closing, so I will now do the closing. Closing, thank you very much for coming to the event. We look forward to the next time something like this happens. I want to remind people that if you are interested in the music that happened, there's an interesting concert happening at Flag Hall at 3 tomorrow with these wonderful players. And also Professor Yu, who's here. Thank you very much. Thank you much for coming. Thank you for sharing your poetry. Thank you to the performers, and thank you to Marlanda.
We hope you visit us again sometime. We're normally open Tuesday through Saturday. And for now, you can take a few minutes to get a closer look at this piece and then just exit right down the spiral out the door. Thank you.